Good evening, CFAY. Captain Dave Glenister here. With me, as always, is Mass Chief Marty King. We are here to discuss some ICE comments of interest to Yokosuka, Ikego, Nagishi, everywhere in the greater Yokosuka family here for our 80-plus tenant commands, those assigned to ships, shore, et cetera, et cetera. So a few things I want to cover first before we get to your comments, and please keep those comments coming. By the time that you are seeing this or downloading it or whatever, we are very close to having the Navy ball on the 5th of October. So just a word, make sure you plan for that event, whether you're driving, you have some folks who are going to carpool, designated driver, going to make the most of some of the transportation that we have set up doing that. And it should be a fun event.
I think it's going to be a great time, sir. The Yokosuka Ball Committee has done a great job all year setting this event up, and they usually hit it out of the park, and I expect the same this year.
Yeah, should be a lot of fun. So have a lot of our good friends from the Kaijo Jietai will be in attendance as well. And Rear Admiral Munch will be our guest speaker, I believe. And I did learn something. Always like to learn new things. I went to part of our year analysis program. One of the things we do at CFAY is we also do a breathalyzer before you go into that. And so, as I am often, many of you know, that I am a big fan of icebreakers just because I end up with a lot of speaking engagements, and that's a way that I can kind of not lose my voice instead of, you know, downing a bunch of bottles of water or something. And so I went in there, and I had an icebreaker. I just kind of chewed on it when I'm walking in there, and I blew a .035. And surprise, surprise, surprise for me. And so the folks there said, hey, if you're on anything, you know, just, no, I did not have my sixth martini breakfast at 10 in the morning as I went out there. But I said, I just had an icebreaker. Oh, that'll do it. I said, really? Icebreaker will do it. So I went and I did all the other mechanics of a urinalysis and then came back and I blew it again, 0.0000 going on there. So news to me about that. So anyway, there's a whole lot of wives' tales and myths about how you can defeat breathalyzers. When I was in high school, it was back when you were allowed to drink at age 18 in the state of great state of New York. But like putting a penny in your mouth and the acid mixes with the copper or some kind of nonsense. So there really is not. I mean, the tests are very, very good. But you folks, you want to not disadvantage yourself. So anyway, don't chew on an icebreaker right before you roll up to a breathalyzer because it may give you a false positive. So how's that?
Yes, sir.
How's that for news you can use?
If they are at a SOBO and they do have a false positive, they do wait and retest that. So
I do. Yep. They do. So it's, you know, truth in advertising. Be honest and say I just took an icebreaker or do whatever. And of course, if you are over the limit, they will know that when they test you again. So don't panic and freak out and say this is, you know, they're out to get me. They're out to catch people who are breaking the law. They're not out to get anybody. But anyway, there you go. So then maybe you may fall into that category. Things coming down the road. It is cooling off here. And as things cool off, as we go transition from summer to fall-like weather, one of the things we look at is transitioning our systems, our HVAC systems, heating, ventilation, air conditioning, over from cool to hot. Now, our systems are a little different than you might have back in the States. They use the same sort of liquid cooling piping, but we actually have to change a lot of that out.
Yes, sir.
Of antifreeze type chemicals and things we've got to change out. So it does take us a period of time to change that over, about 20 days or so, I think, is to go transition as we do that. So we have a schedule that we're going to put out. And you know, when I was here last time, they had some very complicated mathematical formula that said on the number of days, it's below 78 times this iambic pentameter. I don't know what they did in that thing. But you know, it basically transitions from summer to winter just about every year.
Yes.
Here in Japan. So I'm not entirely sure why we hadn't cracked that code. But basically, so we go with the historical norms, and we take a look at those things. But it does take some time to transition that. So starting looking about the 8th or 9th of October, we'll look at the industrial areas. And then the 10th to 11th of October, some of the offices. And then the 14th to 16th, some of the common areas. And basically, by the 18th of October, We are looking at the living areas of transitioning those from AC to the off position. And then there's some maintenance that's got to happen. And there are requirements that we leave it in AC mode before we go to heat mode. And that will cause emotional ism or something for some folks.
Yes, sir. I know.
Now, there is an ability for, especially a lot of these activities, to ask for a waiver. And there's a lot of good reasons. I think with the bowling alley, we asked to leave the AC on a little earlier or turn it on earlier because, you know, the humidity and stuff with the lanes was, becoming a little dangerous. But so you can do that. And for those of you who are so inclined, that instruction is CFAY 11300.2 Golf, and there is a waiver request in the back of that instruction on how you would want to keep this thing open. So please be a part of this. We'll talk about it at our next tenants meeting as well, and just discuss how this goes. And our good folks at NAVFAC are the ones who are the DJ this little dance, and they'll make sure this thing kind of goes. But the sooner, and here's my thought on a lot of this, because I actually spoke with those folks today, the sooner that we shut it off from AC means the soonest we would be able to turn it back on would be 20 days later for maintenance. So hedging our bets against, if it turns really cold, we may not even be able to turn the heat on if we had to. So we want to be able to turn the AC off so we're able to turn the heat on if it somehow gets cold. And there are certain funding restrictions on that kind of stuff, but I'm all about asking for a waiver if it makes sense from higher up for health and life and safety and things. So don't worry about that so much, but we're going to turn the AC off soon so we can turn the heat on if we have to. That's the way you don't want to be. You don't want to be in a place where it's freezing cold outside and you have no ability to warm things up. That's not good. Other things. The Mikoshi Festival on the 20th of October. That is a Sunday. It's kind of an open base event. There's going to be a practice for that on the 13th of October at 12:30 p.m. That's for all volunteers. Great volunteer opportunity.
It is. It's a great opportunity to get into a local Japanese festival and learn the ins and outs and why we actually have a Mikoshi parade. And the volunteers actually have a great time. We're only at about 25% right now on our Mikoshi meter, so we are still looking for volunteers.
Mikoshi meter. Yes.
Yes, sir. We're considering it green because we're not that close to the event, but we do need more participants.
Yes.
So it's a great opportunity. Come on out and learn the culture and have some fun.
It is good. Yeah. If only the world was a big traffic light, it'd be so much simpler, wouldn't it?
Yes,
we're green.
Sir.
So yes, no, but there is a great opportunity to participate in this thing. So if you're interested, by all means, the number is 243-1215. And you can get in on this, and this is kind of a fun way. This is actually the first festival that I ever witnessed in Japan, right after I moved here back in 04. This was the next week there. So pretty good. Also coming up in the month of October, Halloween, and we will be, as one of those things, we let a lot of folks on the base, and we will discuss the day and the timing, probably our next Commander's Corner in about 2 weeks.
Yes, sir.
And we'll make sure that we get that out. Now, there are some other factors in this one. I think the 31st is a Thursday. I think schools are closed the next day.
I'm not sure on that one.
I think I'm pretty sure they are. I'm sure it's not for Dia del Muerte, which it actually is, but All Saints Day, All Souls Day. For all of you from your cultural backgrounds, whether it be Irish, like my wife, or some Latin American festivals as well. So we may end up shifting what day we actually do trick-or-treat based on a whole lot of factors, things that make sense. Because it is kind of an open base event for a brief period of time.
Yes, yes, sir. We do allow people from off base to come on, and they're sponsored. And we do have hours, and once we finalize that.
Yeah, so we'll put that out next time. But we're already kind of leaning towards a few things, but we've got to make sure we've actually thought this through. Nothing worse than putting the word out and having to change it later. That's just, causes emotional trauma we don't need. But we'll put that word out very soon. And when it comes to getting candy, buy early, buy often, because you can go through a lot, especially some of those I think Gridley, I saw this, some post on Facebook said something like went through 4,000 pieces of candy or something. Sounds like an exaggeration, but hey, the world's not only stranger than you imagine, stranger than you can imagine. So I'm not going to question it. So a lot of candy anyway. All right. So one last thing I want to talk about, because there are a few, this is obviously a hot topic, goes right to your quality of life, a few ICE comments about it, which is our housing program. We've gotten some feedback on allowing folks to pick the housing that they want. Those who have participated has generally been positive. In fact, it's all been positive, really. But
yes,
the fact that letting folks go, see where it is. If you have school-age kids, you can pick a house close to the school if it's available. If it's not available, you're not. And that, of course, therein lies the dissatisfaction side. But right now, it is just for people who are newly arriving. And now, some folks have gotten a good deal. Like I said, we're going to learn a lot of this thing. That's why I made it a pilot program, because we're going to make a few mistakes here and there as we try and roll this out. Very tough to transition from one policy to another. And, you know, I ain't going to lie to you. Some folks have gotten a deal they shouldn't have gotten. Hey, that's all right. It's gonna, you know, you ever play Monopoly?
Yes, sir.
You know, Monopoly, you know, you kind of look like Mr. Monopoly. So maybe that's,
Gee, thanks, that's part of that.
It's part of that deal. But I vaguely recall there was like, you get those cards, you know, Chance or Community Chest or something, and it said, tax error in your favor, get $25. There are some folks who got their $25 out of housing here by getting to participate in the pilot program who really were not supposed to, and that's okay. So never begrudge somebody else's good deal just because, you know, you didn't get a chance to do that. So we are kind of still in the middle of that. We are looking at, down the road, several other new phases of this. We're in phase one right now, which is all new people. Make sure we clear that queue, so to speak. And we'll look at how we roll this out or open this up to other folks who are already here. And quite frankly, there's a lot of, there's a few variables in that thing. There are folks who've been out in town, and again, I'm a big fan of folks living on base. That's what we want to do. That's what Scenic wants to do. It saves us money. So whether we move folks from off base to on base or not, whether we say, hey, at PCS, we'll treat you like you just came from out in town and you're going to go from a back-to-back commands here in Yokosuka or something. We have not worked those out. But we are going to continue to implement this program and make it a little bit better. And then eventually get all this stuff. We are going to make it official instruction. It'll stop being a pilot program. But there's opportunities here and to help some folks. And so nothing definitive on that. But we are going to continue to work this forward. All right. And with that, I think we're ready to start talking about some ICE comments.
Yes, sir.
These are always entertaining for both Mass Chief and I, and hopefully some of you. So, all right. Why are Kinnick High School teams allowed to clog the gym every time it rains? There's a line of active duty and spouses trying to work out today, but every machine was taken. 90% by Kinnick athletic teams. And I know that, as always, a lot of these ICE comments come in, and we actually have a response to some of these, and we try to push that response to you, but we want to also talk to some of the folks that, you know, in general, may not have gotten this word. So we'll try and make sure we do that. Always try and add your name and your email, because we will try and get back to you personally. But Mass Chief, what do you think of this one?
Yes, sir. Yes, some of the students do use those facilities. Normally the hours that they're using them are low point hours for the other patrons that are using it. Mm-hmm. Primarily their use is our courts and fields. And everyone has the same ability to go to MWR and actually make those reservations. And the school actually does just that and competes with everyone else. It's reserving the fields and courts. We do have an inter-service agreement with Dodea, but that, as far as the cardio equipment, and which is seems to be the primary concern in here.
So does.
It is first come, first serve, and it's active duty, government employees, and family members all competing in the same pool, sir.
Yeah. So I think, right, so if for instance, you know, I mean, they are all authorized to use it. What I think we want to avoid is kind of institutionalized, you know, which I do not believe we have. We can pull that string. Rained out, let's all walk to the gym together at the same time.
We do not, sir.
So, right, and so nor do we necessarily want to have that policy, because there's a reasonable expectation that the fitness center is for everyone. And no one group, I think we had a comment some time ago about someone wanted to use some of the bikes in an area that were reserved for some other folks. And in that response, we talked about how you really cannot create special things for special groups. So, but yes, no, I agree with you. But, you know, even in the afternoons, a lot of the high school students are authorized to use the gym, even whether they're part of a team or not. So not unlike the way the lunch food court area is clogged.
Yes.
In this term, by high school students. And it's just, it's a peak time. It's a peak volume. So if...
you know. With that as well, if there is a situation like that and it does seem out of the norm, the patrons for that particular facility, whatever it may be, should actually go talk to the either on-duty manager or actual manager of the facility, because they're usually available, and it can usually be worked at that level on the spot.
Yeah, so we should, and that's true too also. If you have an issue with this, by all means, work with MWR as well, and bring attention to the fitness center manager and say, hey, I'm trying to get on a machine, and all I have is all these preschoolers, you know, throwing steel around on the free weights, and we can't have that. And we'll probably, one, we'll agree with you, but two, we'll see what we can do to make sure we have this.
Yes, sir. Share.
And it's not a, wait, we can do that for every machine, right? We have like a sign that says, if people are waiting, only go this amount of time.
Yes, sir.
And so, you know, we may have to kind of make sure we really kind of enforce that thing. Okay. Let's go on to, okay, I made an appointment at 10 o'clock at the BOQ barbershop. And then it says I was there at 9:50, and the barber was just getting finished when a customer walked in, told the barber was late, yada, yada, yada. Bottom line is I think this person had an appointment, and the appointment was not honored. I'm not necessarily clear why. And it says here, and unfortunately, the response that was sent to the person saying, hey, there is procedures for requesting a specific barber. And was explained to the person, that was not explained on here, so we really can't share this one. But I think you were saying this is the what used to be the khaki.
It's only. Yes, it's the Navy Gateway Inns and Suites barbershop,
okay.
Sir. And they do allow an appointment basis over there. Mm-hmm. And I think in this particular situation, they actually have more than one barber. And they had made an appointment with a particular barber,
right.
Which is why, because that barber was not there. However, I believe the Navy Exchange controls that particular barbershop, and I believe
you are correct.
Talk to everyone in regards to that one, sir.
Yeah, no, it varies, facility to facility. Not necessarily here, but in some places they took no, like Pentagon, they have a big barbershop, as you might imagine, a lot of folks, and there are some pre-appointments. But usually, people just take their number, put it next to the barber they want, because there's always, you know, yourself, myself, I used to, you know. Not much you can do with this.
Unfortunately, I don't use the
barbershop. It's a vicarious experience for you, I know, and for myself as well. So, there should be an ability to make an appointment, and those appointments should be honored. I agree with that. And I believe that this particular one was resolved. But I would say as you go into these some of these situations and you're going to make an appointment, there may be some further questions you may want to ask about, you know, is this really going to happen at 10 o'clock? Is there some kind of prioritization? Particularly ones that were, you know, at one time a khaki only type thing. If that particular barber you had an appointment with is also happens to be assigned to the E7 and above chair or something. I don't know particularly, but I could certainly envision some scenarios where that hard 1000 time may not be. And I agree, it probably should be. So I encourage you to, when you make these appointments, to actually ask those hard questions of those folks. Make that happen. Next one comes in from our good friends in Ikego. And my family's just been assigned housing in Ikego. Our apartment is very humid. We're concerned about protecting our personal property from moisture damage. You know, I had a Persian rug that just started getting in the casing, started getting mold on it. Very disappointing. So had to bust that thing open and protect it. But I understand exactly what you're saying. That is not a fun place to be. So anyway, the main base self-help does have units available, but will not allow Ikego residents to use them. Today I spoke with Mr. Churchill, good man out there, at the main housing office. He explained that new units are on order and should be available for Ikego residents next spring. And this is, you know, I'm putting all the housing on the spot, haven't had a chance to respond to this one. This is a fairly, well, not too fairly new, but I don't have any information here, so.
I wasn't able to get any background on that, sir, but we're going to contact the self-help office and find out. I'm not sure if it's because Ikego is part of our installation, but
right.
It's actually separated from Yokosuka. I do have a call in to our housing director to get some more information on that, though.
Right. We have a shared interest in making sure we don't have mold and other things going on. In fact, sidebar story is, we just had a DOD Inspector General team come out and look at our housing.
Yes,
across the board, looked at 78 units and a large number of buildings and things like that, found no mold, which was, you know, one of my big concerns, seeing that, you know, a lot of these houses are older. Since construction, they were meant to be drafty to dry out. Now we've sealed them up for energy and some concerns there. We didn't find any mold, which is good. And there'll be some long-term testing things they're doing. But it's in our best interest to do this too. So I'm sure that Mr. Churchill is on top of this one. But it would seem, and I don't know the answer, on the surface, it may seem like all housing units are CFAY housing units. So if you have these dehumidifiers and you have these houses, it doesn't matter where you live. And I would, on the surface, agree with that. However, it may be that we have a certain number of units that are for Ikego, a certain number that are for the main base. It could be that we have found ourselves in this situation because we, because Ikego housing has been so low for so long and we anticipate things going up. So I'm sure it is not because, those aren't for you people, you're in Ikego. I'm sure that's probably not it, because we obviously don't want that stuff to happen either. It's in our best interest. So, but anyway, good comment from the fact that it has drawn attention to this issue. And housing, I'm sure, is going to be on this. So hopefully we'll get an answer back to you soon, and we'll dig into that. So have some next ones are kind of, I wouldn't say they're not funny, but who's in charge of bicycle safety on base? We all are. We're all in charge of safety in the high science. We'll answer this one and maybe just take a break.
Yes.
I'm imagining no one from the numerous bikes I have to avoid each day while driving on base. Now, I will say that I have jacked some people up verbally as I, you know, called them out. My question is, did you do that? And also, there's another one here further on down. As I walk and drive around the installation, I see people jaywalking. People in the street in crosswalks with earphones and headsets on. Bicycle riders with their helmets unfastened. Motorcycles. I never see enforcement. Well, my question is, hopefully this person enforced it, particularly that the respondent is in a safety professional, the person who submitted this thing. So I guess my snide answer would be, I'll just go to the region and ask for more safety funding.
Yes.
Because actually it is a safety thing. But no, part of the issue, actually I have spoken with our security folks. Just, part of the thing about being CEO is you get some crazy ideas, and other people are forced to answer why. It's the stupidest thing I've ever heard in all my Navy career. But I said, what does it take to, because right now, the number of units we have to look at parking and look at bicycle enforcement, I mean, I would love to have bicycle cops or something. I would love to have, I love to deputize quite a few people on base to just hand out parking tickets. In fact, I may have pad myself every time I go through the hospital parking. I don't know. But there are some obvious issues with that. But no, this is one of those things that, who's responsible for safety on base? We all are. If you feel uncomfortable telling someone riding a bike without a helmet they should have a helmet, don't. You should feel comfortable doing this. And even if you're not comfortable, tell them anyway. Because when they, something happens and they go over and they're now an emergency call out to the hospital, you're going to wish that you had told them to wear a helmet. I do it all the time. Of course, I, being involved in some youth programs, I have a pretty low threshold of calling some kid out on something he's doing wrong. I do it all the time. And you should too. But yes, so the correct PPE and all those things, and we've told the gate guards, hey, feel free to issue tickets to all these people. Call them out and do that stuff. So that your comment about enforcement is spot on. We do need to get a handle on how can we better enforce some of the slower moving people. Boardwalks in some of your bigger cities, states, they have people who are plain clothes, either walking, on bicycle. They're kind of at the same speed as the offenders. Here we have our guys in cars and stuff like that, and they're patrolling a big chunk of area. And apart from like the food court, where it's pretty easy to, people are generally not just transiting through, you can actually hunt them down. So don't be an offender, and by all means, feel free to help us out with that. Help us out with that, and we'll try to enforce those things, because that's why they're there. But yeah, if you're one of these people who sees that, I do it all the time. Actually, someone yelled back at me. I said, hey, aren't you supposed to be off your bike and going through Gridley Tunnel?
Yes.
And you know what I was told? Oh, only one way. Really?
Really.
Those of you who went out at 6:28 on Monday morning. So anyway, I think it's time to take a break here, and we will be back in a few minutes, and there'll be something either informational or hilarious in the break.
Fire Prevention Week is October 6th to October 12th. The theme for this year is Prevent Kitchen Fires. So we're really trying to get out to the community and speak to everyone more, not only the children, but also to the adult community. We're going to have a whole variety of events. On Sunday, October 6th, we'll start off with the kickoff parade. We're going to travel through the housing area. It'll be a line of fire trucks. We're going to have some other emergency vehicles, as well as some city fire trucks with us. Following the fire parade, we're going to have an open house here at our fire station, and that'll start at about 12 o'clock until 4 o'clock. We're going to have a whole variety of events at that, including free food while supplies last, of course. We're going to have a bouncy castle for the children, hose bowling, hose rolling. We're going to have a little maze for everyone to do where they'll be blindfolded to find their way out of a building. We're going to have a craft contest that's open to the adult community, everyone 18 and over, not in high school. And the craft can be of any type at all. Anything that they want to do, just bring it into the fire station by 2 o'clock. Winners will be announced at 3 o'clock. Again, as part of our Fire Prevention Week activities, the drills that we do at the schools, we're going to throw a little twist on them this time. At the elementary school, we're going to have some smoke coming out of a window from a Roscoe fog machine. We're going to have a simulated victim, which will be our little mascot, Sparky. The firefighters will be arriving, they'll rescue Sparky, and then they're going to spray some water. And we'll be doing the same event at the middle school. The elementary school will be on 8 October, with the middle school on 10 October, at 9 o'clock on both days. It's important for parents to know this because we don't want them to panic when they hear the fire alarm at the school and see smoke coming out and fire trucks pulling up. It's only a drill. They don't need to panic. We don't want any parents coming into the school worried about their children for that one. We will also be doing high-rise evacuation drills on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday of that week, the 8th, 9th, and 10th. And those are going to be in the evening at 1800. The towers on those is Ume Tower, Bada Tower, Shobu Heights, Tsubaki Heights, and then Ichiban, Nibon, and Sanban Towers. Those are going to take place at 1800, 6 o'clock in the evening. The reason for that is that's when we'll have more families at home. It's going to be a slight inconvenience for about 15 to 20 minutes for the families while they evacuate, but we do ask that they all participate as it's very important so that they can practice their evacuation plans and the children know what to do in the case of an actual emergency, especially if mom and dad aren't home when an emergency happens and they have to evacuate.
Welcome back. Hopefully you had an enjoyable video on fire safety. It's Fire Prevention Month. Actually, I had this is one of the reasons I'm wearing this uniform today. I had the honor of, this is actually being filmed on a Monday, but had the honor of being part of a retirement ceremony for some of the firefighters out of the Cape.
Yes, sir.
And I was on the business end of their services some years ago. I've got two little kids, had two big accidents, and you know, they survived. They're better people for it. But I mentioned that actually as I speak with them out there. I know it may seem like I am just working my way through my wardrobe. This is three commander's corners, three different uniforms. I suppose I should probably be in my dress blues, navy ball style next time or something, just to keep Mass Chief King guessing as to what to wear to these things. But also channeling my inner airline pilot today in this outfit. Did I tell my brother's an airline pilot?
No, you didn't.
Yeah, he is. He's got a little more hair, a little less face. But other than that, we're very similar. But yeah, I think he got out of the Navy and flew for Delta, so he wouldn't have to actually buy any Delta outfits. He just converted his uniforms over. Something like that. So, and if he wants to, you know, shoot back at me, he can get his own show, and he can do that. All right. So, new comment. It would be wonderful if NWR would be able to offer occasional matinee movies during the week. Maybe once a week or twice a month. They're often adult-themed movies I love to see because I have kids. It makes going to see them difficult. I totally agree. I know exactly what you're saying. In fact, sometimes where we used to have, back in the States, we'd have, you know, our kids have a sleepover. You know, we didn't go out. We just caught up on television that we didn't want we wanted to just watch and enjoy without being interrupted every time. It would also be a nice diversion for those days when you have time to kill on base, but not enough time to make you drive off base. Suppose it won't happen because of all the budget cuts, but it'll be a great thing to offer. Giddy up.
Yes, sir. Good news story.
Gonna happen. See? Your feedback. There you go. So the first and third Thursday, we're going to start doing that, I think, because there are a lot of folks. We have folks at security that work nights. We have folks that have, you know, kids in school during the day, and they're on, like I said, you kind of prearrange your shopping and everything else, and it'd be a nice thing to have. So, yeah, we're going to make that happen. We're going to make that happen. As far as the budget cuts go, these kind of activities are funded by those of you going to the movie theater. You know, we have pretty good cash flow in the movie theaters. I mean, we're talking several hundred thousand dollars a year of flow through things like Benny Decker, in ticket sales and and concession stands, even with the very, very good price deal you get on tickets. So, but that is what allows us to do that. So the more we use the theater, the more we can offer. And so, yeah, we're going to do that. We're going to take you up on your suggestion. Kristen, there you go. Shout out to Kristen there who came up with this idea. And we're going to do that. Congratulations. The Kristen program.
There's some more good news on the theaters, though,
there
too.
There is. Why don't you bust that out? I've been talking a lot.
We're starting this Friday, October 4th. We're going to open up the Fleet Theater again. And then we'll have both theaters going. So, but when we do the matinees on the first and third Thursdays, they'll be over at Benny Decker, I believe.
They will, yeah. Benny Decker, that's not a bad place to have it, purely from the standpoint of that's where most folks will probably be with their time to kill. Either because the kids, shopping, whatever. Not to say that, you know, you can't play hooky from your ship and go to the Fleet Theater. That would probably be a good deal for you guys, but that's not what this program's about. So, no, we'll do that. But, yeah, so we had the Fleet Theater was closed over the summer when most of the ships were out or planned to be out. And then we took that opportunity to actually redo the floor in there. So the reason it has not been open of late is really because of the maintenance going on. Wrap that up, end of the fiscal year, 30 September, and I think we're good to open. So there you go. We're good. Let's see. There's a couple of these things that are person-specific. They had a particular problem, which I'm satisfied with the answer on those. There are some folks who call out some bad service, and by all means, and in this case, they did actually give their name and contact information. We did follow up, and there we go. So we're good on some of those. But I'm not going to call out some of the bad service stuff, but thank you for putting your otherwise we get a he said, she said. You know, you say someone did something wrong or wronged you or disrespected you, and then all we can do is really go with the written comments, whereas we may need to dig deeper. And in this case, we have, and we've taken some action on that. So, okay. There's a comment here. The air hose has been replaced, the air pump down at the auto port. I know that was an interest item for some folks. I guess it was leaky. You can never get above 30 PSI without, you know, blowing on a hose yourself or something like that. I don't know. But, no, I think that has been repaired, finally. They had something going on there. Clamp on that hose was not holding. But
yes, and they replaced it.
Yeah, they did. So, again, the people have spoken. So good. Okay, here's a good one. This comment concerns fraud, waste, and abuse of government property. Now, some of these, I say, always try and keep them objective. And always keep your words soft and sweet, in case you have to eat them, as may be the case here. So, and I say that only because this comes from Iwakuni. And you can go onto ICE system anywhere, and I think that this was a particular one where they noticed a government vehicle parked at the base gas station at Iwakuni, Marine Corps Air Station. And the license plate number, they get the license plate number. And on this offending vehicle, it said, "Go Kinnick, go Red Devils." And of course, go Red Devils, of course, right? But anyway, in the comments, it goes on to say it was quite obvious this government vehicle was from Yokosuka Naval Base. Of course it is, home of the Red Devils. And was probably being driven by employee. Okay, anyway, it goes on and on. And this person can't accept the idea that this was for official business. Disappointed. Okay, well, the bottom line is you're going to be even more disappointed when you hear my comment or Master Chief's comment on this one.
Thanks, Captain.
That's all right. Am I going to put the smack down on some fraud, waste, and abuse thing in a government vehicle?
We did the research on this.
Uh-huh.
And the Dodds vehicle was used in support of a approved Kinnick High School sporting program, so they were actually authorized to use that government vehicle for that particular instance.
Indeed. Yes. Indeed. Yeah. So, and here's the bottom line. I know we're having a little bit of fun with this one here, but what it boils down to is that being that we are a little different, being Okonis, our school is a DOD school. It is federal. Right? It is not state like all the schools you're used to. And those rules for vehicle use, and this is an official thing, it is funded, it is Dodds, and yes, they can, and yes, they did use the vehicle. There's no problem with that. I think it is great that you're putting your comments out here. You want to avoid fraud, waste, and abuse, and those kind of things. There's a little bit of emotion in here about who should be doing something, and I hope someone gets the bottom. I hope someone gets the bottom of this violation of the rules. You assumed it was a violation of the rules. Turns out it was not. Okay, I appreciate you calling it out, but turns out no, there's no problem. Actually, the vehicle use is a big ethical. There's a whole ethics piece of the ethics instruction on vehicle use. Things like, I drive my vehicle when I'm on official business, drives right past my residence often, and in no way, shape, or form will I ever take it to or from my house or place of residence to from work. That is just, everybody, and pretty much everybody knows that is like big ethics violation right there. But the rules and use of the vehicles are pretty stringent. A lot of folks know that. So good for keeping us honest. But in this case, you are mistaken. It was an authorized use. There's a similar situation. Didn't come in through the ICE comments, but did it come in through personal correspondence regarding the half staffing of the American flag. Do you recall that little case?
Yes, sir. That was about our flags being flown on the installation at all of the areas that fly our flag throughout our base here in Yokosuka. And you get into the U.S. code on that, which particularly addresses continental United States.
It does.
And our outlying territories. However, we are not here in a territory. So our flags were actually appropriately flown on those days.
Right. So as I often mention to our folks at AOBICR, we are not in the continental United States. Now, if you're on a ship, and most sailors are, especially we grow up on ships, and we know that a warship of any nation is the sovereign territory of that nation. So if you are on a ship from the Liechtenstein Navy, right, that's the sovereign territory of that country, no matter where it is. You can't go on board, you can't inspect it, you can't do whatever. That is not true of a naval station overseas. This is squarely Japan. So I believe it is Title 36 of the United States Code that dictates those things. I'm somewhat familiar with that because I've been able to participate in certain flag retirement ceremonies and honors and customs that are a little bit off the beaten path. Most folks do not retire a flag unless you are a party to some kind of official ceremony thing. So it does not come up a lot. So I happen to know where to look some of the stuff up. So the fact is that if we want to half staff our flag, the American flag, for a reason, we can. But it is in no way our business to tell some other country what to do on its own territory with its own flag. And it would have been a coincidence beyond comprehension if every person on this base who has served the military got it wrong. So some of those things, yes, good for calling out, but keep it objective. Because as it turns out, the individual that thought that somehow we were disrespecting the U.S. flag by having other flags fly higher was incorrect. It would be disrespectful for us to half-staff the Japanese flag, as it turns out. So, but what you're referring to is other state flags, other flags.
Yes.
All will go half-mast, but not the country of another flag, particularly when you're in that country, or the flag of another country, the country of another flag. Okay? On to some custodial services comment. I'm not sure if this is the right place to comment on this, but I want to let whomever is in charge of the cleaning staff that cleans the towers, the lady who cleans the Miyajima Tower, Setsuko Takano, is great. So that's very pleasant to hear. And it goes on to not just her cleaning service, but her courtesy, and what a great person. So, that's great to hear. And I will pass that on. And, of course, we're passing on here for everybody else. So that is great. And they do a great job. I'll tell you what, they got to put up with quite a bit, too.
Yes, sir. They do. They clean up after us. And some of the stuff that folks do around here is pretty inconsiderate, and these folks do it. They don't complain, and they always do a good job. And so, feel free to send us those good news stories, but at the same time, feel free to tell them right on the spot that you actually appreciate the work that they're doing. Yeah. There's nothing wrong with that.
That's right. They do a good job. And speaking of doo-doo, which is where you're going with this, there actually is, if you're at all on Facebook, you will know that there are some folks who left some rather unwanted trash in the stairway of one of the towers. And I can't believe that, well, I guess I can believe it because I get to hear this stuff. But yeah, somebody decided to create a big health hazard in the stairwell of one of these towers. And someone's got to clean that stuff up. And that's unfortunate that, I mean, of course, anyone who has kids knows it can be a rather unpleasant experience, even if you're in love with the person that you're cleaning up after. So can you imagine if it's a stranger? No, we don't want any part of that. So, so my hat's off to the cleaning staff across the board. But we have a responsibility as well to do the right thing, report those issues if there are health issues. Don't shove your water bottles and your wrappers and your cans in the bushes around the base and all that stuff. And we'll look at getting more.
Might be a good opportunity to mention that because of our exord and the fact that we did cut down some of our janitorial services, because we get a lot of comments that base is getting overgrown and there's a lot of trash. We all have assigned areas to take care of on the installation. And everybody's got to do their part in this time.
I think maybe we should have, adopt a highway. You know, we haven't adopted. We've actually told people you own this thing.
Yes, sir.
So maybe we should put, some pictures up of that command's logo all over that area that is trashed and, somewhat inspiring. Actually, I had a CO that we were getting ready for some big inspection. And on a ship, there's a valve maintenance program. And there's valves everywhere. I mean, there are thousands of every system. And so the captain was a big engineer himself, and he would see these valves that were clearly not, they were subpar. They were below fleet average, in his opinion. And so he had these tags made with the picture of the auxiliary officer's face. And every time he saw a valve he didn't want, he tied it on there to remind someone, fix that valve. So I don't think we'll be doing that on this base. It is just kind of fun to joke about, but we do. We all have responsibilities on the base. And people are keeping up with those responsibilities. But if you throw your trash everywhere, someone else is going to clean it. And that's just rude. And just hold on to it. Throw it out. Throw it out when you get a chance. In the right place, please. Help us out with that. And it just makes everybody feel better. I mean, how do you fix the neighborhood is how you fix the windows. Ever hear that? Some cities. You make people take pride in their appearance. And off we go. In fact, I just had the pleasure of awarding the Yard of the month,
sir.
Yard of the month. Yep. And great stuff. Okay, on to something else that's not my problem. But I'm going to read it anyway because I share your concern. It's about AmeriCable. And the rest of you, and the oxygen's done being sucked out of the room. Let's go on with this one. This is the 14th time in 19 days my internet is only working for 2 or 3 minutes here or there. I work from my computer and cannot work or get paid if my internet is not working. Now, I assume that you're doing your commercial business within the boundaries of the AmeriCable agreement and those agreements with the country of Japan on doing that stuff. Some folks, Netflix and others, some folks have special rules for how they do that, so I'm sure you're doing that. If not, you may want to consider it based on what you're doing. But that's not what we're here to talk about. So basically, they call tech support and it works for a short time, goes right back to being I'll say substandard and not use these words. But in going to a hotspot from my phone or my laptop, to Starbucks, the next, there's zero hardware problem. Okay, let me see if I can read this again. I either have to go to hotspot my phone or tap my laptop, take my laptop, I assume it means, to Starbucks or the next just to get my work done. And there's zero hardware problem, so it's all on their side of things. Well, if I may channel my inner nerd, and as Master Chief knows, I actually have a degree in computer science. Now, that degree is from 2004, so it'd be kind of like knowing how to build a log cabin and trying to work on a skyscraper at this stage. Technology has changed slightly. But I will say that there are some things you can try and do to at least make sure that it is AmeriCable's problem, and there's certain things that you can do. So. I'm assuming, because it doesn't go into detail, because you probably weren't thinking I'd read this, whether you have a cable modem, router, connection type configuration, which you probably do. But there are some things you can do. There are some reasons why this may not actually work. When I was in college, back in the 1800s, we actually had a new engineering building, and they ran these wires through it, and could not figure out why they could not get a signal from point A to point B through there. I mean, everything was working fine. They take the wire out and plug it, like the computers next to each other, and they run it back to the wall. And turns out that because there was so much metal in there that it was creating this field, it was swapping bits around and just distorting the signal, things that they had never thought of. So if you have other cable connections in the house, if you're using a wireless router, the way I do it is I have my televisions in one room coming off the cable box, et cetera. And the question is, if you have a television cable, does it also trip offline? Because if it doesn't, that will go to the quality of the signal. Now, the signal travels on a different frequency. Master Chief, jump in here anytime.
No, sir. Okay. You're good.
All right, good. So if the television does not freeze, which sometimes mine does as well, but the internet does, that'll tell you that at least that for some part of the signal traveling to your house, it is good. Travels different frequencies, about 1030 megahertz or something like that, I think. And there's an uplink, downlink frequency. So what I do is I have my actual cable modem and router in a completely different part of the house. So if you have other cable connections, try and plug it in there and see if that something changes. Also, you can change where the router is, you know, if it's close to a wall, close to another piece of metal, close to something else. Because what ends up happening is inside your router, there's something called these collisions, as all these bits try and talk to each other but can't. It's kind of a simplistic way of looking at it. But it does end up filling up buffers and things, and sometimes you have to reset to clear that out. So if you can get rid of some of those errors, it might actually fix things up. So I try and move your cable modem somewhere else. Maybe even try and borrow someone else's router and see if the router's a problem. Could be it. But if your cable television's working fine and your computer is not, that is also something to when you talk to AmeriCable, mention that as well and help them half split this problem. So, but I do know it is a bit of frustration, but try that piece as well. And then still doesn't work, there's not much I can do. I don't really work for AmeriCable, but there are reasons why some of these things happen. You can always ask them for another cable modem as well, and or even the cable that connects them. So there's things you can try. And oh, by the way, one last point on that. If you have like the Radio Shack type cable that goes from the wall to that thing, that is totally different than the cable you actually get from the cable company. I mean, it is, for those of us nerds, that is really garbage cable. So try and use the one that they gave you, like the one they actually cut for you and make it, and that might actually help solve some problems too. So anyway, that's a long answer to a dissatisfied customer. I don't know, maybe hopefully you try something. Maybe something works. I don't know. Sometimes I just got to get that out of my system. You know. Okay. Okay, here's one from the it relates to the Fleet Fitness Center, but it talks about across from Port Ops, there's a thing called the Hawk's Nest, I guess.
Yes, sir.
You know, and it talks about the AC that's over there. And as I understand it, let's see, the Hawk's Nest AC issue to my attention. The gym is a great setup and a favorite of the three fitness facilities of many on board CFAY. However, rarely is anyone able to work out this facility to the high temperature inside during the day. Reminds me of a fan room on a cruiser I converted to a gym. It became the fan room that time forgot there. But can we anticipate AC being installed next summer? Now, as I understand, the gym was created as kind of like, here's a space of opportunity, and we tried to make the most of it.
Yes, sir. That's exactly what we did. And we actually had to shut it down this summer because the temperatures in that space were well above our black flag limits. I can say that MWR has submitted a work request to have the HVAC, heating, ventilation, and air conditioning in that particular space redone so that space becomes has the ventilation required. But with that, we have to wait for the approval and the funding dollars to do that. Right now, what we're doing is we're looking to contractors to provide temporary fix with cooling fan units, somewhat similar to some of the sports teams you see on the sidelines,
right,
to be able to use there until we can get this HVAC corrected.
Yeah, so we'll try and do that. Got to increase the ventilation in there, and we'll see what can be done. But, you know, like I said, we're using a space not as designed. We're trying to make the most of it. We'll see what we can do. I think I only got a few minutes left here. Got a shout out to AOBICR, Mr. Spilder, and Doug Knight from Traffic. So congratulations to you guys. I go to AOB ICR twice a week, actually. I go Mondays and Fridays. So they do a great job. Here's some tree pruning on a Kago. It's too extreme. Extreme tree pruning. I think they have that on ESPN4. as a special sport.
But yes, sir.
Tree pruning on a keg is too extreme. This is a quality of life issue for all of us who enjoy the beauty and change of season of the trees. My backyard view will look like acid rain. It is horrible. Have you ever seen acid rain?
I can't say I actually have seen.
No, actually, I've seen what it can do, though. And also, the sometimes on the side of some of these roads in the Northeast, they have all the salt on the roads. And in the wintertime, the summertime, it dumps off and browns everything. So hopefully that is not the case. But basically, we prune the trees for a number of reasons. One is typhoon season. We don't want trees falling on cars, which we had three of them. In the last
yes, we did.
Last storm landed on cars. Luckily, did not land on anybody. And also for the safety, we don't want kids. Even say we have the force protection fences, but even the smaller fences that are designed to help keep the kids from running back in there in a keg, especially that thing. We don't want the trees to where the kids can go up and climb on them and hop over these things. So the tree pruning is going to happen. So. Hopefully the tree growth will follow in the springtime. But some stuff we've got to do. I lost power for 5 days when I was in D.C. because they didn't prune the trees. And 200,000 people were without power just because they all came down on power lines, which we hopefully won't have that problem, but it can be a problem. How are we doing on time? What we got? Okay. There are pros and cons sometimes with all these different things. The pool. I had a very long comment I skipped over until this moment. About how they really don't like the fact that we've shallowed up. I don't think that's a word.
We installed a floor.
It looks like it actually is pretty neat the way they did that. But and that is so everyone can use the pool. So Roger, you're you may be into swimming 50 meters, but we also are into making sure that everyone can use that pool. And we're going down to one pool because we don't have multiple pools open. For monetary reasons, and I got to have my 2 foot and 3 foot kids be able to use a pool as well. So we do have kick turn ability. We can put kind of a line of a soft wall in there as well. So we can do quick turns
yes.
in that and cut that in half. And I regret that you may be inconvenienced by the fact that you can't do an Olympic length pool swim as you do your laps and stuff. But you know, needs of the many outweigh the needs of the few in some cases. And I don't really view it as a big operational loss for that thing. So I regret your inconvenience. But I also, it's another other comment, love the new floor, well worth the investment, so much friendlier to families. I agree. Here's another one. Big fans of Club T. It's Club Takamiya out there in Akego. And with the increase in Akego residents, can we expand services and hours? Well, that is also a non-appropriated fund account, which means it pays for itself as more residents go out there, and as it's more profitable to do that, I'm sure we'll take a look at that. I was out there for brunch.
Yes, sir.
Just for that very reason, went out there on Sunday.
And one of the items that happened here with Club T, one, we just remodeled it. They did a great job. But when the CNIC X word actually came out, it directed an MWR hiring freeze, even for our NAF positions. Mm-hmm. However, we've been authorized to hire more staff for Club Takamiya. Mm-hmm. And we currently are actually, MWR is accepting applications for those waiter and waitress positions there. So one of the issues Club T has is they don't have enough staff. Mm-hmm. And I talked with Mr. Paul Lopez, our MWR director, and they're working real hard to get this back up to speed, so we do get enough staff and are able to support all of the families.
That's good. I think we, in general, we advertise a lot of the jobs we're looking for.
Yes, sir, we do.
FFSC and some other places, you can certainly participate in that and look into that. So one last thing we'll mention here, and then we'll sign off here, is regarding this person had their oil changed, and they're concerned about the price of it compared to what's available out in town. And my understanding is, if you look at the prices out in town, and we did actually go back to this individual, they thought that the price was rather expensive, but the price out in town at Autobax does not include filters. You gotta be a member of their whatever the kind of service contract thing they have or something.
Well, they do have an Autobax card out there, sir, but anybody can get their oil change. I actually take my cars out to Autobax usually as well.
Okay.
But when you get an oil change, it's not an oil and filter change.
Right.
They're just changing your oil. And the next auto port here, you're changing out your filters too, and that's why their price is higher. But we have our options. They can go off base and use those facilities, or support the next auto mart here on the base. That's a personal choice, but in this particular incident, that is why the price of an oil change on base is higher, because they don't change out the filter. Out in town, they don't. The filter is extra.
That's right. Extra price. Yes. I would encourage everyone to always look at your options, no matter what that is. You should always have a plan B, whether it be for auto service, for shopping for your groceries, for your entertainment needs, whatever. One of the reasons we get a cost of living allowance is because we know that things are expensive out in town, and that is meant to enable us to use those facilities. But I think now is the time to get comfortable at least going out there and taking a look around and shopping around what is out there in the economy. Sometimes you can get a great deal. Sometimes you can't. The home store, the Costco and other stuff. Pokemon store, if you want to go to Yokohama, you're in for your Pokemon needs or something. But I think, you know, during normal times, when normal things are happening, it is now's the time to kind of make that excursion. Absolutely shop around and do that. But know holistically what you're paying for. And I think in this case, we may have answered that question.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I think that's going to do it for us. We'll try and do this every 2 weeks or so, so we don't build up our comments, make this too long. But please keep them coming. Please tell us who you are so we can respond to you and get some of that more information or more detailed answers.
Absolutely.
And hopefully have a great week. Welcome to the new fiscal year, if you're just tuning in. And
hope to see him at the Navy Ball this coming
see
at
Navy
Saturday.
Ball. Please have a plan for that. Have a safe, fun event. And we'll see you next time.